Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis Session by Shankar IAS Academy, dated 6th June 2021. The list of topic for today's discussion is given for your reference along with the page numbers in various editions of the newspaper. Now, let us move on to the first topic for today's discussion. The first topic discussion is regarding this news article, Job Creation Needs a Boost, says Gangwar. This article is regarding the statement made by the Union Minister of Labour and Employment while addressing the virtual meeting of the non-aligned movement labour ministers. See, this happened under the 109th session of International Labour Conference, where the Union Minister has said that in order to counter the impact of ongoing pandemic, a greater support shall be provided to healthcare systems, social protections and job creation. In this context, let us discuss in brief about the non-aligned movement and then about the International Labour Conference. The syllabus covered under this topic's discussion is given for your reference. See, the non-aligned movement was created and founded during the period of decolonization and at the time when several countries from Africa, Asia, Latin America and other regions of the world were struggling for independence. Also, note that this NAM began to existence at the height of Cold War. Here you have to know that the Bandung Asian African Conference held in Indonesia in the year 1955 is the immediate antecedent to the creation of non-aligned movement. Also note that there were principles that were proclaimed at that conference. The principles would govern relations among large and small nations known as the 10 principles of Bandung. Such principles were adopted later as the main goals and objectives of the policy of non-alignment. Also, the fulfillment of those principles became essential criterion for non-aligned movement membership. The 10 principles of Bandung is given here for your reference. The aspirants can have a look at it. See, these 10 principles of Bandung were majorly concerned about the fundamental human rights, sovereignty and territorial integrity of all nations. And in addition, the recognition of equality among all races and equality among all nations were emphasized. The rest of the principles will also be covered while we discuss the Bandung Conference. Let us move on to the discussion of non-aligned movement. See, after 6 years of Bandung Conference, in the year 1961, the summit of non-aligned movement was held in Belgrade in Yugoslavia. See, this conference held in Belgrade was attended by 25 countries from Asia and Africa, where India is also one of the participants. See, the founders of NAM have preferred to declare it as a movement but not as an organization. Also know that the 5 people were known as founding fathers of non-aligned movement. They include Abdul Nasser of Egypt, Kwame Nkrumah of Ghana, Jawaharlal Nehru of India, Ahmad Sukarno of Indonesia and Joseph Broz Tito of Yugoslavia. You have to note that the primary objective of the non-aligned countries were focused on the support of self-determination, national independence and sovereignty and territorial integrity of states. It also includes other objectives like opposition to apartheid or non-adherence to multilateral military pacts and the independence of non-aligned countries from great power rivalries and influences. See, we have already said that these were the countries which have already been colonized in their earlier periods and have gained independence after a long period of struggle. So, the NAM is generally a struggle against imperialism in all its forms and manifestation. This includes the struggle against colonialism or neo-colonialism, racism, foreign occupation and domination, etc. Here, the non-aligned countries also emphasize on non-interference into the internal affairs of state and peaceful coexistence among all nations. In addition, the NAM countries also reject the use of threat or use of force in international relationship. In addition to it, the NAM countries aims at strengthening of United Nations, thereby democratizing of international relations. See, one of the NAM's core objective is socio-economic development and restructuring of international ecosystem. And along with it, they also emphasize on international cooperation on an equal footing. So, it is very clear that many of its objectives are still very relevant. Now, let us move on to International Labour Conference. See, the broad policies of International Labour Organization are set by the International Labour Conference. This conference meets once a year in June in Geneva, situated at Switzerland, bringing together the representatives from government, worker and employers delegates of the ILO member states. Often, the International Labour Conference is called as the International Parliament of Labour, where the conference establishes and adopts international labour standards. See, it is also a forum for discussion of key social and labour questions. In addition, this International Labour Conference also adopts the organization's budget and elects the governing body. Note that during this International Labour Conference, each member state is represented by a delegation consisting of two government delegates, an employer delegate, a worker delegate, and their respective advisors. Note that many of the government representatives are cabinet ministers responsible for labour affairs in their own countries, and the employer and worker delegates are nominated in agreement with the most representative national organizations of employers and workers. This is all about the International Labour Conference. With this, we have come to the end of this topic discussion. Now let us move to the second topic. This is the second news article. Revival of road in Tiger Reserve shocks activists in southern districts. See, this article is based on the road construction in Meghamalai Srivalliputtur Tiger Reserve. This is in news because activists allege that this is a blatant violation of the Forest Conservation Act in a critical tiger habitat. See, you have to know that any road construction inside reserve have to be approved by National Tiger Conservation Authority and the Supreme Court appointed Central Empowered Committee. Here, this road construction is seen as a violation of these norms. In addition, the activists have already petitioned the National Tiger Conservation Authority for this issue. In this context, let us look into the National Tiger Conservation Authority, the Project Tiger, Tiger Reserves in India, as well as the Srivalliputtur Meghamalai Tiger Reserve. Let us start with National Tiger Conservation Authority. See, the NTCA is a statutory body. See, statutory body means a body which is created or constituted as per a statute or law. If you see, this National Tiger Conservation Authority was constituted under the provisions of Wildlife Protection Act of the year 1972. This National Tiger Conservation Authority comes under the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. And as per the Section 38L subsection of the said Act, the authority consists of Environment Minister as the chairperson. In addition, this authority also includes the Minister of State in Ministry of Environment and Forests as Vice Chairperson and includes three members of Parliament, Secretary, the Ministry of Environment and Forest and other members. Its main purpose is to strengthen the tiger conservation in India. Also know that they prepare an annual report which is laid down before the Parliament. In addition to this, the National Tiger Conservation Authority coordinates the Project Tiger. This Project Tiger is nothing but a centrally sponsored scheme of Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, where under this program a central assistance is provided to states that have tiger population. This is for the conservation of tigers in designated tiger reserves, and one of the tasks under this Project Tiger is the creation of Special Tiger Protection Force. Now coming back to the NTCA, this National Tiger Conservation Authority conducts All India Tiger Survey every 4 years. Till now, 4 censuses have been completed where the recordings of primary field data are done digitally through mobile phone applications like M-Stripes. M-Stripes is nothing but the monitoring system for tigers, intensive protection and ecological status. Also know that the recent census uses GPS to geotag photo evidences. Along with it, a tool named CatTrack, which is nothing but the camera trap data repository and analysis tool, is being employed that took the aid from artificial intelligence. See, the latest 2018-19 census was the most accurate and found about 2,461 tigers in existence. See, some of the notable findings are given in the infographics where the aspirants can have a glance of it. One of the peculiar findings in the survey is that there were no tigers found in Baksa, Dampa and Palamu tiger reserves. But however, all these efforts have paid off and we now house around 70% of tiger population. And last year, India got into the Guinness Books of World Records for largest number of tigers. See, the map of tiger reserves in India is given for your reference. Aspirants can have a look at it. Now moving to the tiger reserves, know that there are around 51 tiger reserves in India. The latest to be notified is this Srivalliputtur Meghamalai Tiger Reserve, which is in the news. Note that The Srivilliputtur Meghamalai Tiger Reserve was notified very recently in February 8 of the year 2021. Let us know about this area in brief. See, this serene tiger reserve comprises of Meghamalai Wildlife Division and Srivilliputtur Wildlife Sanctuary. And the southwest side of the tiger reserve is bounded by the Periyar Tiger Reserve in the state of Kerala. Whereas the northeastern side of the tiger reserve is bounded by the Elumalai Reserve Forest. Also know that this Srivilliputtur Wildlife Sanctuary is also named as Grizzled Squirrel Wildlife Sanctuary. Here, Srivilliputtur Wildlife Sanctuary was established in the year 1988 to protect the vulnerable grizzled giant squirrel, which is also called as the Ratufa macroura. Note that the Srivilliputtur Wildlife Sanctuary is bordered on the southwest by the Periyar Tiger Reserve. And if you see, the Srivilliputtur Grizzled Squirrel Wildlife Sanctuary forms an important landscape for elephant conservation in Periyar Tiger Reserve. Owing to its large contiguous forests and connectivity with adjoining reserve forests, this wildlife sanctuary has wide varieties of endangered species. The endangered species includes grizzled squirrels, elephants, tigers, leopards, Nilgiri tar, Indian gaur, and lion-tailed macaque among the large mammals. And the significant parts of Meghamalai landscape encompassing Varishnad Hills, Kambam Valley are declared as the Meghamalai Wildlife Sanctuary. Note that this together forms the newest tiger reserve in India. And this is the fifth tiger reserve in Tamil Nadu, which is crucial in two aspects. First, it will maintain the vital forest contiguity between the Periyar Tiger Reserve in Kerala and the Kanyakumari forest in the extreme south. Another important aspect is that it will be an extremely important buffer for the spillover tigers of Periyar Tiger Reserve. Another important point, this high ridge gives birth to the Vaigai River in the Tamil Nadu and Mullayar River in state of Kerala. Hence, in this discussion, we saw in detail about the National Tiger Conservation Authority and about the Project Tiger, Tiger Census, and also Srivilliputtur Meghamalai Tiger Reserves in brief. With this, we have come to the end of this topic discussion. Now let us move to the next topic. Now let us take up this news article. Insurance scheme asks to settle claims faster. Recently, the Union Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman issued a statement urging the insurance companies to speed up the settlement of pending claims under the scheme named Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Package Insurance Scheme. Note that the insurance companies have processed just 419 claims till now concerning the frontline healthcare workers who had lost their lives in the COVID-19 pandemic. In this context, let us discuss the Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Package concerned with insurance scheme for healthcare workers fighting COVID-19 mentioned in this news article. See, as the name clearly says, this is the insurance scheme which is related to the life insurance scheme for healthcare workers fighting the COVID-19 pandemic. Know that this scheme pays rupees 50 lakhs in case of loss of life due to COVID-19 and in case of accidental death on account of COVID-19 related duty. Now let us know who are all covered under this scheme. See, the public healthcare providers, including the community health workers who may have to be in direct contact and care of COVID-19 patients, are covered under this scheme. Also note that this scheme covers private hospital staffs who are in COVID-19 duty. Another important factor here is that there is no age limit for this scheme and individual enrollment is not required. See, the entire amount of the premium for this scheme is being borne by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare itself. Also, the benefit or claim under this policy is in addition to the amount payable under any other policies. Now, coming back to the news, according to the Finance Ministry, so far only ₹209.5 crores have been disbursed under this scheme. So, the ministry urged the insurance companies to process COVID-19 related claims of healthcare workers on a priority basis. Also, the ministry has simplified the process to speed up the insurance claim. As per the new mechanism, a simple certificate from the district magistrate endorsed by the nodal state health authority would be sufficient to process such claims. Note that it also extended this Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Package scheme for healthcare workers for one more year after the emergence of second COVID-19 wave in April of this year. With this, we have come to the end of this topic discussion. Now let us move to the next topic. Moving to the next news article, Emergence of Order from Chaos in Turbulent Systems and Bose-Einstein Condensation. This news article is based on the system conducted by a team from IIT Madras on the Bose-Einstein condensation. Know that this is similar to the condensation that is taking place in the turbulent systems of aircrafts and rockets. Also, this study is expected in helping develop early warning indicators for handling chaos in turbulent systems such as aeroelastic flutters in the wings of aircraft and thermoacoustic instabilities in rocket combustors. In this context, let us discuss in detail about the Bose-Einstein condensation. As we know, all the matter is made up of atoms and there are several natural states of matter. We all know that in the solid phase, molecules are closely bound to one another by molecular forces, whereas in case of the liquid state, the molecular forces are weaker than in solid, while considering the gaseous state of matter, the molecular states are very weak. Following this, there came the study of matter at very high temperatures and pressures, which typically occur on sun or during re-entry from space. This study of matter finally led to the findings of fourth phase of matter, that is called as plasma. See, under this very high temperatures and pressure conditions, the atoms themselves begin to break down. Hence, as a result, the electrons are stripped from their orbit around the nucleus, leaving a positively charged ion behind. The resulting mixture of neutral atoms, free electrons, and charged ions is called as plasma. See, this plasma is a fluid, and because of the charged particle present in the plasma, it responds to and generates electromagnetic forces. With this, we saw about the solid, liquid, gaseous, and plasma state of matter. Between all these, there is a fifth state of matter, which is the man-made Bose-Einstein condensates. See, the Bose-Einstein condensate was created in the year 1995 by using a combination of lasers and magnets. Know that two scientists cooled a sample of rubidium to within a few degrees of absolute zero. At this extremely low temperature, the molecular motion comes very close to stopping, and as a result, there is no kinetic energy being transferred from one atom to another, hence the atoms begins to climb together. Thus, there are no longer thousands of separate atoms, but just one super atom. So, the Bose-Einstein condensate is a group of few million atoms that merge to make a single matter wave about a millimeter or so. Know that the Bose-Einstein condensate were predicted by the Indian physicists Satyendranath Bose and Albert Einstein during the 1920s when quantum mechanics was still new. Now, coming to its applications, the Bose-Einstein condensate is used to study quantum mechanics on a macroscopic scale. Note that the light appears to slow down as it passes through the Bose-Einstein condensate, allowing scientists to study the particle or wave paradox. Also, a Bose-Einstein condensate has many of the properties of superfluid. Superfluid is nothing but a fluid that flows without any friction. In addition to it, the Bose-Einstein condensate also used to stimulate conditions that might exist in the black hole. So, in this discussion, we have learnt about the Bose-Einstein condensate and about plasma as well as the application of Bose-Einstein condensate. With this, we have come to the end of this topic discussion. Now, let us move to the next topic. Our next discussion is going to be based on this news article, Kashmir Roadmap Must for Talks. The article reports about the statement made by the Prime Minister of Pakistan on India-Pakistan relations. According to him, Pakistan is ready to begin talks with India if New Delhi provides a roadmap towards restoring the previous status of Kashmir. So, in this light, let us see a brief overview of Kashmir issue between India and Pakistan and also the important points mentioned in this news article. The syllabus covered by this news article is highlighted for your reference. See, before partition, the state of Jammu and Kashmir was one of the 565 princely states. These princely states were not under the direct control of British colonial administration, but rather they were retained a great degree of autonomy to manage their own affairs. this degree of autonomy to manage their own affairs were provided except in defense and foreign relations. Note that during the partition, the princely states were not directly incorporated in either domain, and they were granted the option to stay either independent or to join any of the two dominion. Also, the ruler of Kashmir, Maharaja Hari Singh, initially wanted Kashmir to be independent. But later, in October 1947, he chose to join India in return for India's help against an invasion of tribesmen from Pakistan. This resulted in a direct conflict between two countries, following which India approached the United Nations asking it to intervene. Later on, in the year 1949, in the month of July, India and Pakistan signed an agreement to establish a ceasefire line as recommended by the United Nations. According to it, the northern and western part of the former princely state named as Azad Kashmir was administered by the government of Pakistan, whereas the northern areas, which is known as the Gilgit-Baltistan and the state of Jammu and Kashmir, acceded to India. Note that this ceasefire line, later on officially named as the line of control following the Shimla Agreement that was signed in the year 1972. Note that this line, which is nothing but the line of control, is not actually a legally recognized international boundary. But this line of control prevails in practice as a de facto boundary. And the purpose of the line is to avoid arms smuggling and infiltration by the Pakistani-based separatist militants. Now, remember Article 370, which offered a certain degree of autonomy to Jammu and Kashmir, unlike other states, such as providing a separate constitution, allowing the state of Jammu Kashmir to have its own penal code, a separate flag, and a special clause of permanent residence with a range of benefits were all given under this Article 370, was scrapped by the present government. Now, coming back to the news article. According to the Pakistan Prime Minister, they have always wanted a civilized and open relationship with India, as it would enhance the trade and also help in reducing poverty in the entire subcontinent. And the Pakistan Prime Minister also stated that they are ready to restart talks with India on a condition that the New Delhi provides a roadmap towards restoring the previous status of Kashmir. In addition, he also expressed his displeasure over Indian government's act of revoking the autonomy of Kashmir. See, Kashmir has been a buffer zone for Pakistan in its security strategic formulation. This is because it served Pakistan well in formulating its Kashmir policy. Also, Pakistan's deep state has infiltrated various levels of public life in Kashmir Valley and finds it easy to operate from its bases in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. Also note that a troubled Kashmir Valley suited Pakistan, as terrorism and separatism were the new normal of Kashmir Valley. And because of this, Pakistan gained from it. While the Indian government was always firefighting in Kashmir, this proxy war game served Pakistan's agenda in the region. So at such a scenario, a separate rule of law in Jammu Kashmir means that its direct and sponsored activities on either side of line of control in the state was problematic. Similarly, with the local government coming under the direct control of New Delhi, provides a lot of chance for the information to reach the central government directly. And most importantly, the change in status of Jammu and Kashmir means that a better coordinated security force would be deployed on the line of control for keeping a tighter vigilance on Pakistan's activity. So, it is because of these reasons, Pakistan government is not happy with the move that scrapped the Article 370. See, by keeping in mind the neighborhood first policy, India desires normal neighbor relationship with Pakistan. There are a lot of issues which doesn't go smooth for India and Pakistan, but however, India's consistent position over them is that the Kashmir issue should be resolved bilaterally and peacefully between India and Pakistan in an atmosphere free of terror and violence. Also note that India has made it clear that it will not compromise on issues relating to national security and will take firm and decisive steps to deal with all attempts that undermines India's security and territorial integrity. So, these are some takeaway informations from this article. And with these informations in mind, let us move on to the next part of the discussion. Our next news discussion is going to be based on this news article, Karnataka High Court rejects plea of Kerala man charged by NCB. See, this news article is about the seizure of some narcotic substance by the NCB. And in this context, let us know about Narcotics Control Bureau from prelims perspective. See, our national policy on narcotic drugs and psychotropic substance is based on the directive principles contained in the Article 47 of Indian Constitution. And our government's policy on the subject flows from this constitutional provision, and in addition, it is also guided by the several international conventions on this subject. See, India is signatory to several international conventions based on narcotic drugs. For example, India is a signatory to Single Conventions on Narcotic Drugs 1961, the Convention on Psychotropic Substance 1971, as well as the United Nations Convention Against Illicit Traffic in Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substances 1988. Flowing from that, the broad legislative policy is contained in three central acts, namely the Drugs and Cosmetic Act of 1940, the Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act 1985, the Prevention of Illicit Traffic in Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act 1988. See, the responsibility of drug abuse control is a central function, and in that way it is carried out through a number of ministries, departments and organizations. And if you see, it is the Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substance Act of the year 1985, which came into effect from November 1985, made an express provision for constituting a central authority. The authority constituted is for the purpose of exercising the powers and functions of central government under the Act. Note that in the presence of this provision, the Government of India constituted Narcotics Control Bureau in the year 1985, and this NCB functions under the Ministry of Home Affairs. And note that the National Control Bureau is the apex coordinating agency, where it also functions as an enforcement agency through its zones and subzones. These zones and subzones collect and analyze data related to seizures of narcotic drugs and psychotropic substances, study trends, and collects and disseminate intelligence also. In addition to it, this NCB works in close cooperation with the customs, state police, as well as other law enforcement agencies. And the bureau has several functions to perform, which are listed so that aspirants can go through it. See, the major functions are like coordination of actions by various officers, state governments and other authorities under various relevant acts. And also, one of the major functions of NCB is the implementation of obligations under various international conventions and protocols. In addition to it, it also provides assistance to concerned authorities in foreign governments and international organizations to facilitate coordinations and universal action. See, the broader objective of this NCB is to prevent and suppress any kind of illicit traffic in these drugs and substances. With this, we have come to the end of this topic discussion. Let us now move to the final topic. Now let us take up this news article. United States delays tariffs against digital services tax. This news article reports about the United States consideration on retaliatory measures. So in this light, let us see about the retaliatory measures and the reasons behind it. See, the Office of United States Trade Representative takes over the responsibility for developing and coordinating US international trade. And the Section 301 of the US Trade Act gives this United States Trade Representative the authority to investigate as well as to respond to an unfair action on foreign countries which negatively affects the US commerce. In addition, this act also provides the United States President to impose tariffs or other curbs on such foreign nations. Making use of this provision, former President Donald Trump tried to promote free, fair and reciprocal trade and also to close the gap or balance of trade with those governments whose trade practices are found to be disadvantaged against the US firms. As per the investigation, digital services tax imposed by six countries were found to be discriminatory against United States tech firms. And the six countries are Austria, Italy, Spain, Turkey, United Kingdom and India. Hence, at present, the Biden administration as seeking a middle path in this issue by allowing some space for tax negotiations with the nations concerned. And this was evident in the recent action by the US administration, where the US government announced and then immediately suspended a 25% tariffs on 2 billion imports from these six countries. See, this tariff was imposed as a retaliatory measure against the imposition of digital services tax, which impacted giant tech corporations of Silicon Valley. Coming to India, see, recently the Union Cabinet gave ex post facto approval for the government amendments to Finance Bill 2021. This amendment was aimed at clarifying and rationalizing tax proposals for the year 2021-22. And this Finance Bill 2021 introduced an amendment which imposes a 2% digital tax on trade and services. See, this 2% digital services tax on trade and services or on non-resident e-commerce operations with a turnover of over ₹2 crore. And according to the estimates by the USTR, this tax could yield approximately $55 million annually. This move by the Indian government was seen as a restriction on trade from United States' point of view. Hence, for this reason, the US government imposed retaliatory measures as we discussed earlier. But later on, this move of retaliatory tariff was suspended for 180 period in order to give some time for ongoing international tax negotiation. And it was also because the countries are impacted by the pandemic. So at such a juncture, opening a new trade war could be damaging both for them as well as for the broader global economy. Hence, let us see what India has to do now. See, if India holds negotiations with Washington on the 2% digital services tax, then there are chances for it to result in the scaling back of this tax. And this means that a part of this revenue would be lost to the exchequer depending on the final rate agreed. But on the contrary, if India moves forward in imposing it, then around $118 million of India's exports to the United States, which includes 26 categories of goods, would be subjected to the tariff proposed by United States Trade Representative. So, due to these reasons, it is important for India to consider its options carefully at this juncture. And note that it should consider an option that prevents itself from getting into retaliatory taxation, since it damages India's growth prospects. Also, at the same time, India should ensure that it doesn't abandon its intent to tax global tech firms, which are generally enjoying low tax operations across numerous jurisdictions. With this, we have come to the end of this topic discussion. Now, let us move to the prelims practice question session. First question: which of the following leaders are considered as the founding fathers of the non-aligned movement? First, Gamal Abdel Nasser. Second, Mahatma Gandhi. Third, Kwame Nkrumah. Fourth, Woodrow Wilson. Select the correct answers using the code given below. Options given are option A, 1, 2 and 4 only, option B, 1 and 3 only, option C, 1, 2 and 3 only, option D, 2 and 3 only. See, this is a simple question. We have discussed it earlier also. Let us do a recap. As we have discussed, 5 people were known as founding fathers of NAM. They are the Gamal Abdel Nasser of Egypt, Kwame Nkrumah of Ghana, Jawaharlal Nehru of India, Ahmad Sukarno of Indonesia, and Josip Broz Tito of Yugoslavia. Hence, the answer for this question is option B, 1 and 3 only. Know that Mahatma Gandhi, though advocated many principles of NAM, he was not the founding father. Also, Woodrow Wilson was the 28th United States president who was instrumental in the formation of the League of Nations after World War I. So, Woodrow Wilson is not related to non-aligned movement. Hence, the answer for this question is option B, 1 and 3 only. Coming to second question, with reference to the Project Tiger, consider the following statements. Statement 1, it is implemented by National Tiger Conservation Authority. Statement 2, it is a central sector scheme. Which of the statements given above is or are incorrect? The options given are option A, 1 only, option B, 2 only, option C, both 1 and 2, option D, neither 1 or 2. See, the first statement says it is implemented by the National Tiger Conservation Authority.
Yes, as we have discussed earlier, we know that it is implemented under NTCA. Hence, the statement 1 is correct. But while considering the second statement, you have to know that the Project Tiger is a centrally sponsored scheme of Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. And the purpose of this centrally sponsored scheme is to provide central assistance to states that have tiger population. So, the second statement is wrong. Hence, the answer for this question is option B, 2 only. See, you have to be careful while answering such questions. The question asked is, which of the following statement is incorrect? Second statement is incorrect. So, the answer for this question is option B, 2 only. Moving to the third question, consider the following statements. Statement 1, Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Package Insurance Scheme is a life insurance scheme for the health workers fighting the COVID-19 pandemic. Statement 2, the benefit or claim under this policy is not in addition to the amount payable under any other policies. Which of the above statement is or correct? The options given are option A, 1 only, option B, 2 only, option C, both 1 and 2, option D, neither 1 nor 2. As we have discussed, the PMGKP insurance scheme is for the healthcare workers fighting against the COVID-19 pandemic, and the scheme pays rupees 50 lakh as insurance package in case of loss of life due to COVID-19 and accidental death on account of COVID-19 related duty. Hence, the statement 1 is correct. But while considering the second statement, the features of the insurance scheme mentions that the benefit or the claim under this policy is in addition to the amount payable under any other policies. So, the second statement given is incorrect, and the answer for this question is option A, 1 only. Now, considering the science and tech question, which of the following statement is correct regarding the Bose-Einstein condensates? Option A, it is the fifth natural state of matter typically attained during a re-entry from space. Option B, for the first time, BEC was created by cooling gold filaments to absolute zero. Option C, BEC is a group of few million atoms that merge to make a single matter wave about a millimeter. Option D, none of the above. See, we have discussed that Bose-Einstein condensate is a man-made element undergoing several experiments, and in that case we studied that it was created in the year 1995 by cooling a sample of rubidium to within a few degree of absolute zero. Hence, first statement is also wrong, and second statement, which says it was created by cooling gold filament to absolute zero, is also wrong. Now, coming to the third statement, BEC is a group of few million atoms that merge to make a single matter wave about a millimeter is a correct one. We also studied that this was predicted by Indian physicist Satyendranath Bose and Albert Einstein in the year 1920. The answer for this question is option C, BEC is a group of few million atoms that merge to make a single matter wave about a millimeter. Moving to the fifth question, with reference to Narcotics Control Bureau, consider the following statement. Statement 1, it was established under the Narcotics, Drugs and Psychotropic Substance Act of the year 1985. Statement 2, it is under Ministry of Finance. Which of the statements given above is or incorrect? Option A, 1 only. Option B, 2 only. Option C, both 1 and 2. Option D, neither 1 nor 2. As we saw in the discussion, the statement 1 is correct. NCB is established under the Narcotics, Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act of 1985, which acts as an apex coordinating agency and enforcement agency through its zones and subzones for the purpose of prevention and suppression of illicit traffic in drugs and substances. And this NCB functions under the Ministry of Home Affairs. The second statement given here is that NCB functions under Ministry of Finance, which is incorrect. So, the answer for this question is option B, 2 only. As the question demands, which is the incorrect statement, the answer for this question is option B, 2 only. Now, coming to the last question, consider the following statements. Statement 1, the Office of United States Trade Representative takes over the responsibility of developing and coordinating US international trade. Statement 2, Section 301 of the US Trade Act gives the United States Trade Representative the authority to investigate and respond to an unfair action of a foreign country which may negatively affect US commerce. Which of the statements given above is or correct? As we saw in the earlier discussion, the US Trade Representative takes over developing and considering US international trade. And for this purpose, the Section 301 of US Trade Act is invoked to investigate and respond to an unfair action of a foreign country which may negatively affect US commerce. And the both the statement given in this question are correct. Hence, the answer for this question is option C, both 1 and 2. These are few mains questions that are given for your practice, and you may write and post them in the comment section for peer review. That's it for today's discussion. If you liked the video, kindly press the like button, comment, share and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy for further updates. Thank you.